Good morning, here's my outfit of the day. Today I am wearing a top from H&M. I don't know if you remember, but a couple weeks ago I wore a black and white sweater that was the same thing as this, and I liked it so much that I bought a couple more. So I bought one in this like peachy color. I'm also wearing some stretchy pants from Old Navy that I bought a couple years ago. I'm wearing my black flats from Aldo. This necklace that I believe is from Old Navy, and then my black and gold Michael Kors watch. So spring break is over, it's Monday morning, and I will talk to you guys probably on my way to work. Okay, it is 7:30 on the dot, and I am going back to work from spring break. I don't really have anything to report for my spring break. I didn't go anywhere or do anything special. I really just stayed at home, relaxed, did a lot of adult type things. Like, I had to get my car registered for the year. I had to renew my AAA. I had to get my tires aligned. So it was a lot of stuff like that. And then I spent some time with my mom and family out at her house. My sister had some days off as well, so we got to hang out, but that was pretty much it. I didn't really do anything. I couldn't really afford to go anywhere or do anything because I am a single girl on a budget. Speaking of which, some of you did ask some questions for a Q&A, but it's not quite enough yet for me to make a full video, but I did note some of the questions down. So if over the course of time more questions come, then I will be sure to do a Q&A. And one of the questions someone asked was about budgeting, like, how do I budget for my life living in Southern California, which can be expensive, and being on a teacher's salary. So that will probably be included somewhere in a Q&A, or it could be a separate video, just depending on what I decide to do. But as far as today, it is the Monday after break, which is always a little bit harder. Luckily for us, our Mondays are minimum days, so that makes it a little bit easier. This week I think is going to be a little bit busy because today I have a parent meeting at 4:30. The timing of that meeting is a little frustrating because it's a minimum day, which technically means I would be able to leave at 3:15 because I'd have gotten quite a bit done from 1:15 to 3:15. But I have to stick around and wait for this parent meeting. I have a couple meetings tomorrow. I think a staff meeting on Wednesday, so the usual. But this parent meeting today should be interesting because I think it's going to be me, the parent, and the principal. And this parent and I have a decent relationship. They've come before observing the class, you know, gave me credit for being able to work with a room full of 32 kids, and you know, the whole thing about I don't know how you do it. But at times I think this parent misunderstands like what is truly going on in class with their child. So their biggest concern right now is their child's performance on math test, and he is very capable, but for whatever reason on math tests, he just like really breezes through these tests and doesn't really show work and finishes, oftentimes will finish before I think he should be done based on what I know of the test. And there have been numerous occasions where, because he's finished so early, I've pulled him to the back, looked over his test, told him to go check some problems and sent him back. And the last time I did that, I texted the mom to let her know, you know, this is what happened. I had to give him his test back because he had a lot of them wrong. And when he goes back, I'm not even really helping him with the test. I'm just telling him these are wrong. And he's able to self-correct, which tells me he knows how to do it when he is forced to take his time and work through it. And but every time on a quiz or a test, it's as if he chooses not to do it. And so his last test, he didn't do as well as she would have liked. And as a solution, she asked if his dad can come in with him when he takes a test and sit with him while he takes a test, which I think to a parent sounds very feasible, like a good idea. And her thing is like, you know, I would send my, his dad would come in there and sit with him while he takes the test, not to help him, but to be like a visual reminder of you need to slow down and take your time, which again to parents probably sounds like a good idea. But for me as a teacher, that is not a good idea for a couple of reasons. Number one, it is distracting to that child. That's some extra pressure now with the dad sitting there. Number two, it's distracting to the other kids in class because now there's an adult there. And number three, if I offer that to this one child, I could potentially have a set of 30 some odd parents come in every test day watching their child take a test, which is not good. I mean, I don't think that would ever happen, but theoretically it could. So I'm going to meet with her and the principal to go over some options. Like, what are some other strategies we can come up with? Because I don't really think that's going to work, especially given the fact that our fifth graders are transitioning to middle school next year. And that's just not realistic to think that in a middle school, you're going to have your parent come in with you and sit down with you when you take a test to make sure that you know to take your time. Like, now they are not the age where something like that is a bit much. Like, they need to be weaned off of that and they need to learn that is their responsibility when given a test, that they use all the tools that they have been provided. And one of those tools would be the time to show your work. And in my class, tests are untimed, so he has the time. It's just he has to want to put forth the effort. So I'm gonna have a meeting at 4:30 with the parent and the principal about that. I don't think it'll be contentious or anything. Like I said, I have a pretty decent relationship with this parent, but they are just very into advocating for their child, which is a good thing, but sometimes in efforts to advocate for your child, you start to come up with ideas that may sound good when you say them, but in reality aren't really going to help your child the way that you think that they're going to help them, if that makes sense. So we're going to talk about that. But aside from that, I am officially in the home stretch to summer break. Spring break is over. We don't really have any breaks between now and the last day of school. The only break I will have is that my birthday is coming up and I always take the day off. My birthday is March 31st and this year it's on a Friday. It is also the same day as my mother's birthday, so her birthday is also March 31st. So we always take work off and just spend the day together. And so I will have a little 3-day weekend for my birthday. But aside from that, there are no breaks and this is going to be that busy time of the year where now open house is coming, wrapping up the school year is coming. Tomorrow we have a promotion meeting, or end of the year meeting I should say, for parents that are interested in helping, and it's just going to be a whirlwind of activities because it always is. And then on top of that, as excited as I am about my transfer, I'm still very excited about that. To add to the things that are already a part of the end of the year for me, I also have to pack up my entire classroom, and that is kind of a scary thought. So I'm going to try and pack up a little bit along the way so that it's not just this massive task at the end of the school year. But over spring break, I did buy a couple of items for my new classroom. If you follow me on Instagram, I have officially decided that my classroom colors will be yellow and gray, which are the same as what's in my house, I know. But I just really like that color combination, and I just like the idea of putting it in a classroom because they are very soothing colors. So I bought some paper, some faceless paper, and some border. I'll probably need to get more because I know it, I don't have quite enough just yet, but I'm just buying little bits at a time so that it doesn't feel like a huge financial strain in one sitting. So anywho, I am just now getting to school. So if you're on spring break, I hope you enjoy your spring break. If you're just getting back from spring break like me, I hope your first day back from break is as pleasant as can be. And I will be sure to check in with you guys a little bit later today. Hey everyone, it is 3:02 and school's been out for almost 2 hours. After school today, I checked my email. I forgot to upload or update Schoology, which I need to do really quickly, and sent out some reminds. And then I went to vote on our tentative agreement for our district contract with a couple of other teachers, and I just got back from that. And of course, I stopped in the office and chatted for a little while. So I'm getting ready to update Schoology, but then I need to go pick out some new guided reading books for the week because I have not done that. And I honestly have not pulled a guided reading group in a while because we were leveling and then it was the week before spring break and then things just kind of got in the way. So I've been a little off track with that. So give me 1 second because I have learned that I cannot vlog and type all at the same time. So let me update my Schoology page and then I'll get back to you guys. So 1 second. that is done. I had to upload something and then put their homework on there. So I need to go pull some guided reading books. And I think I need to tweak a little bit somewhat of what I do with guided reading. I think I'm really just gonna have to focus on the kids that are not quite at grade level, because I have a class of 32. And on average, it can take me 2 days to finish going through a whole guided reading book with the group. And as bad as it sounds, quite honestly, in guided reading, the priority really is the kids that are not reading at grade level. The kids that are at grade level or above are not in as dire a need of my time as the kids that are below. So what I think I'm gonna try and do with the kids that are above is maybe focus on supporting them more through the reading conferences that we have from their response journals, but rarely will I probably pull them back for a guided reading group because they just are not the priority. And that sounds bad, but right now the priority are the kids that are not quite where they need to be. So I am just looking at this chart here that we were given at the beginning of, I think, this school year or some point last year. And it's a Fontes and Pinnell chart that just tells you along the side here the different grade levels and then the three different points of the year where you're checking and where a student should be in terms of the reading level based on the grade level they are in. So I teach fifth grade. We are in the second interval of the year, which runs through February through March. So I need to be looking at any child that is at a level T or below. Those students that are at a level T or below are considered to be under the expectation of what we would have. So in my class right now, I have a total of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 11 kids that are below that level T. A handful of them are RSP students, so they are usually meeting with Ms. Hood, our RSP teacher, but the rest are here. So I am going to go find some books for those kids. In my plan book, I've put down what group I want to start with this week, but I need to go find the book. So I will take you guys along to our little reading collection that we have. And allow you guys to witness me picking a book for guided reading, and then if I have time, kind of go over what the book is, why I chose it, and just go from there. Aside from that, the day went pretty well. We actually got through everything on my agenda. We even fit in reading Walk Two Moons, which we've been reading reading at a much slower pace than what I would like. And that was really it. I just feel accomplished because we got through everything. The math lesson today was a little bit challenging because for whatever reason, I think this is the first year I've gotten to this lesson, or the first year that I actually taught this lesson, because normally in my TEs, I have notes of all the lessons I've taught, and this one was clean as a whistle. There was no notes, no highlights anywhere, and it was just a metric measurement. It was a little bumpy to start, but I think by the end of it, the kids had the hang of it. So one of the things I just put on Schoology is a metric conversions chart to kind of help them with their homework tonight. But what I like about it is it just reiterated that they can convert or do their conversions with metric measurements by relying on what we've already learned and talked about in terms of powers of 10. So that was the focus of today's lesson. So anyway, I'm gonna head to the other classroom where all these books are at, and then I'm gonna look for some books for my kids. So I'll talk to you in a second. I finished that parent meeting probably about 15 minutes ago, and I think it went as well as it could have gone. While this set of parents are very friendly, they are very passionate about what they believe and what they want, so we came up with a bit of a compromise. We're not going to have a parent actually come in and into my classroom while they're taking the test. We're going to try and provide an alternate setting for their child to see if that works, and then go from there. So that is the resolution. The principal is going to set up her schedule, or take a look at her schedule, to see if there is somewhere else that the student can take the test at a different time, to see if that kind of helps with his focus while taking a test. So that's where we're at with that. I
what was I supposed to do? Oh, I think the last thing I was doing was I was picking out a guided reading book, and I don't know if you can tell, I recorded myself looking for the book. I don't know if I'll include it, but if you did, you may have been able to tell that I was kind of at a loss as to what book to pick. And if I don't include it, I was at a loss as to what book to pick. The challenge is that we don't have a ton of books. And I think some teachers here at the site take multiple sets of books at a time. So I was looking for a level N/O, which is, what is that considered? Let me look at my chart. So I'm looking for, or I was looking for a group or books for this group who ended up at a level N/O. Remember, I said at this point in the school year, the fifth grader should be at a T or above, so they are below. And a level N/O is around the third grade level. So the challenge is finding a book that I think will be engaging for a fifth grader to read, but it can't be too long. Like, honestly, right now I'm not at a place where I can do guided reading off of chapter books because I don't have time to read the chapter books to know where I want to take the discussion. And some people will say, well, you don't have to read the books, just kind of be familiar with it or look at the book summary or something. And I just am not comfortable doing that. I'm not comfortable leading a guided reading book on a book that I'm not fully familiar with and that I haven't completely read. So the challenge is finding a book that I can actually use. So, and that I hadn't done already. So a lot of the books there that I saw were either too long or the ones that were shorter I had already done. So what I chose is this book here. It is, 1 second. Miss Robinson. All right, sorry, that was the principal. I think what I was talking about was getting my guided reading book. And so, I think that's what I was talking about. Anyway, the book I chose was The Story of Anne Frank. Anne Frank, it's a level N. And this was my best option because it's not too long, if you can see. I think I can read through this tonight and kind of decide where I wanna go, what I wanna do with it, and be ready for tomorrow. And I think it will be interesting enough to the kids to be engaged. And I have not read it with any of my groups, so I know there's no risk of me repeating it. So I'm taking a copy of this home, and then I have journals that I need to read. But all in all, it was a good day back to work. You know, that first day back is rough. I got up, I went to the gym, got that done, got through everything on my agenda for the day, and now I'm headed home to cook a Blue Apron meal, I believe. So I am going to end it for the day here, and I will talk to you guys tomorrow. See you then.
Good morning, here's my outfit of the day. Today I am wearing a hand-me-down for my little sister. This is a dress that I actually bought for her birthday that she no longer could wear, so I'm wearing it as kind of like a tunic over some leggings from J. Crew. I'm wearing my brown boots from Nordstrom, and then my black and gold Michael Kors watch. And then I found these little like fake leatherette bracelets in my closet. So I put those on and that is it. So I will talk to you guys later.
Hey everyone, I am sorry that I am vlogging in the dark of my car. It is 7:47 and this is the first time that I'm able to talk to you guys today because it's been one of those days, and when I woke up this morning, I knew it was gonna be this way. Today, I had to teach, obviously, and then I had to leave school right after school because I had an Inspiring Leaders meeting today at 3:15 at the district office. Today's topic was just basically how to support your staff as an administrator, and then we talked a little bit about social and emotional learning and what that's all about and why it's important. That ran a little bit later than normal, so I left there after, it was probably around 5 actually. My intention was to go home, let Genesis out, have her use the bathroom, and let her be free from her little confined area. But since the meeting ran late, I didn't get to go home because I had to go back to school. make sure that the presentation for our meeting with parents was ready for tonight. So as a fifth grade team, we chose to have a end of the year informational meeting for all of our fifth grade families, because there's some things that happen at the end of the school year for fifth grade students and their families that are specific to fifth grade, and sometimes they can be a little bit confusing or overwhelming for parents to understand and know. So this year we decided to try and hold a meeting where we kind of go over everything. So I had to come back to school, work with Liza and Cindy or Mrs. Haston to make sure that we had everything together. Then we had to do the presentation, and then I left school at about 7:15. I thought, it's raining here tonight, and I thought it's a perfect night for a broth bowl from Panera, so I tried to order that, but they were out of stock, probably because everybody thought a broth bowl for dinner would sound good on a rainy Tuesday evening. So that meant I had to drive a little bit further to a place called Waba Grill to get dinner. I just picked that up, and now I'm driving home, and I'm tired. So I was gonna vlog when I got home, but the way I feel right now, I know that when I get home, as much as I love and enjoy vlogging and all of that, when I get home, I know I'm just gonna wanna get my pajamas on, sit on the couch and eat dinner. But I didn't wanna not check in with you guys today because I just didn't wanna do that. So, I am on my way home. As far as the meeting, it went well. So in that meeting, we go over, the big piece is the calendar, the fifth grade calendar, some events and dates that parents want to know about. We also talk about citizenship points, and what I wanted to do was kind of show you guys the letter and kind of talk about our system a little bit more today, but I didn't get a chance, but I will probably go over it more in more detail at some point this week, just in case you guys are interested what exactly it is we do. And but the parent meeting went well. They seemed to understand how it worked. And then after that meeting, we also met with some parents who expressed an interest in helping us with our fifth grade promotion ceremony and some of the end of the year activities. So that went well. My day with the class went fairly well. We got through everything. The only hiccup was during the social studies lesson, I realized I ran the wrong copy for the lesson that we taught. So I had to scrap the little worksheet that I was going to do with the lesson. But that just meant we got to listen to Walk Two Moons, and the kids love that book, and we ended on a very suspenseful part, which was fun. And then I went to my meetings, and now I'm going home. So that is it. I don't want to ramble. And I have chest pains, I think from anxiety. So, and I'm tired. If you follow me on Instagram, last night we had a meeting, and I got home from the meeting, and then I ended up talking to someone on the phone for a little while. So I didn't end up eating dinner till 9 o'clock. I went to bed late, and I think that's why I'm a little bit tired. So I have chest pains from anxiety, and I'm tired. My anxiety is just, I'm in the midst of, you know, trying to be patient with trying to support a student and the parents, but I'm at a point where I feel like the parents aren't really understanding, like, what is feasible for a teacher to do and what is a feasible amount of communication and an appropriate level of communication and expectations from me as opposed to not. And I'm trying to, you know, be patient about it, but there are times, I'm having one of those times where I feel like I have a parent who's not understanding that I have a full class of kids. Like, I have 32 students, and some of the requests that they are making are just really not feasible and to some degree not really appropriate to me in terms of being fair. So just in a very short period of time, I was contacted by this parent in 4 different modes and literally within a span of minutes because I wasn't responding to messages right away. And I don't know.
I mean, I know there's some of you out there that are parents watching this, and if you are, this is kind of the part where teachers get frustrated. Like, I mean, you guys have seen my vlogs. I'm working all day, every day, on my weekends and whatever. So there's only one of me, and there's only so much time in the day, and there's only so much that I can do. And I like to think that I do go above and beyond the bare minimums. So when I have situations like this where I feel like I'm already quite accommodating, to then still be made to feel like it's not enough or you need to be doing X, Y, and Z, it's frustrating. And I think that's giving me chest pains because I'm tired and I'm frustrated. So anyway, we had a staff meeting after school today, and it was done in record time. And just before that, we had our little union session where me and the other union rep that was there at the meeting just kind of updated the staff on what happened at the last union meeting. And it really was just a rehash to let them know about contract negotiations. We had voting for that on Monday, and we found out yesterday that the majority of the teachers that voted approved it. So we are officially done for the school year. So the next step for that is that it just has to be board approved, which it will be, because the board is the set of people that helps to let the district know what they are willing to negotiate with us, if that makes any sense. Someone's calling my phone right now, and I don't know who it is, so I'm not gonna answer it. So just kind of going over that, and then some of my anxiety may also be, I kind of shared with them that in the process, or in the results email that we got from the person that's in charge of elections, we were told that just under 200 teachers voted. Now in our district, we have over, I believe, 600 teachers. So I was just telling the members here of my school site to just kind of pass on the word that as a person that spent a lot of time out of my classroom and preparing for and going to the negotiations table for the general population of teachers, it's kind of disheartening to know that we're spending all that time as a team advocating for them, and less than 50% of the teachers took the 10, 20 minutes out of their time to vote. The voting itself takes like a minute. It's getting to the place to vote that might take a little extra minutes. And like I've said before, we don't work in a very large district. So the school where they had the voting set up was centralized, so it wasn't going to take anyone an extreme amount of time to get there. And it's open, the voting location was open before school, after school. Yesterday was a minimum day for elementary teachers, so you were allowed to go during your minimum daytime. So it's, you have ample time to go vote. So for me, there really is no excuse to not vote. Like, I get that everybody's busy, but it literally would take you just a minute to do, and you can't take for granted that everything will be fine and everything will work out and let the other people vote and take care of it, because you don't know that to be the case, and that may not always be the case. And so the point that I was making here when we were having that meeting is just, you know, it does kind of make our negotiations process a little bit more difficult when we're trying to tell the district that this is what teachers want, teachers feel passionate about this, but then when the number of people that voted comes out and it's less than 50%, that doesn't necessarily look like the teachers really want this and they're really passionate about this. So I just asked them to pass that message along to their friends that work in the district. And if you're a teacher out there and you know you have a negotiations team that goes to the table for you, and you kind of feel like when it comes time to vote for your contract that it doesn't matter if you vote or not, or it's not a big deal if you don't, just know that, or just remember that there are people out there sacrificing their time in the classroom and sometimes our free time to kind of get you the things that you feel like you need. So that was a little disheartening, but what are you gonna do? So I think what I'm gonna do is I'm going to pack up my belongings. I am going to head home because I'm just ready to go home. And poor Genesis was all by herself all the way until about 7:30-ish last night. And she didn't get a walk because it was raining. So I wanna go home and get her on a walk. And I'm going to take my response journals home. Unfortunately, I think I'm gonna have to kind of assign kids what I want them to do in these journals, because I am finding quite frequently I'm having to tell the kids that you need to put forth a little bit more effort in your response journals. Like, some kids are literally saying, in this story, it's about a boy who has a brother, and I wonder what his brother's like, and I have a brother, and that's the extent of it. Which if I felt like that was truly the best that that particular student could do, I'd be fine. But this is from students that I know could do much better than that. And so I was trying to avoid kind of pigeonholing them into what the responses had to be. But we may come to that. So today we also met with the district representative who kind of checked in with us about Wonders and how are we feeling. And I feel like I haven't talked about Wonders in the longest time on this vlog, and I talked about it quite a bit in the beginning, and I haven't talked about it a lot because it's been kind of on pause. Because one of the things I mentioned to her is that the challenge for us is that we have these writing PLC goals that we have to do, and Wonders is already jam-packed with a ton of stuff to do, that it really is impossible for us to concurrently teach Wonders and be doing what we need to do to get these writing goals under control. And so you have to stop one to do the other. So writing was a big focus for the last couple of weeks, not to mention I was in and out a lot. So I really was on a pause, and I'm behind probably at least a few weeks behind Liza and Cindy at this point. So that was one of the things we mentioned, and it sounds like everyone in my district is struggling with learning how to get everything fit in. The upper grades we asked about are having a hard time trying to find time to do those small groups, because it just, for whatever reason, it's that is the hardest part across the board for everyone. But again, the person that is our support system was very nice, very understanding, and was really just asking us what suggestions that we have, what would we like to see. And I said, from my perspective, I think it would make us feel better if we didn't feel so pressured to be moving at a certain pace. And even though the district just kind of said you can take the time you need, there's still that feeling that they're saying, well, right now take the time you need, but eventually we do think that you'll be able to get through these learning blocks in 1 week. And we are just about done with the school year, and none of us at that meeting can even fathom how you would get all of that done in a week. And there's still components to the program that we really feel need some kind of supplement, and our kids as students are struggling with the content and knowing how to properly take the tests and all of those things. So the comforting part was, it was nice to know that our side is not the only one struggling with those things, and that our struggles are very common struggles. So that was what came out of that meeting. That was during our PE time today. And then today, aside from that, it was just a typical day. It was kind of nice. There was a little bit of time where I had a much smaller class because there was a band field trip, so a good chunk of the class was gone for the day, which made teaching a little bit more easy. And we got through everything, and that was really it. I don't even know what I want to say, because I feel like I have not offered much these past couple of days because it's just kind of been all over the place. But I hope you guys don't mind, and I hope you don't feel that way, but that I feel bad, like I'm not giving much to you guys this week because I've been busy and I haven't really vlogged too much. So anyway, I'm gonna pack these things up, and then I'm gonna head home and read the response journals that were due today at home, because I got backed up there. I just finished the ones that were due yesterday, and technically they should have gotten those back first thing this morning, but because of me being here so late and having two meetings and having dinner at 9 o'clock, I didn't quite get to that. So now I'm caught up. So I'm gonna take the ones that were due today home, read them, return them tomorrow morning, and hopefully be back on track.
Morning, here's my outfit of the day. Today I'm wearing some older pants from New York & Company. I'm wearing a cream colored top that actually ties in the back and has a little bow, but it's covered. This is from Charming Charlie, and it's also something I've had for a while. The sweater is from New York & Company, and it's also old. And then this scarf is from the gift exchange I went to over winter break. This is my first time wearing it. I'm wearing some flats from Macy's, and then my silver and gold Michael Kors watch, and a couple of Alex and Annie bracelets. So that's it. I'll talk to you guys a little bit later.
Can I just say I want to be Gwen Stefani when I grow up? I am just wrapping up typing in my question of the day. And I think I showed you guys this a long time ago, but basically I ask the students, it's just like a silly question of the day and it just makes taking attendance fun. And I use the timed PowerPoint slides from, I don't remember who this is from at the moment, but I know I've linked it in a separate video, but I use these timed PowerPoint slides that are also editable. So for this one, I put the question of the day. It says, have you ever been to the circus? And so students will say yes or no, and that's how I take attendance. And then I always play a song in the morning, and that song is the amount of time that they have to unpack. So I am going to play Make Me Like You by Gwen Stefani. I'm not sure what version of the song I'm going to play because I was just listening to a few remixes of it. And just to be on the safe side, I always listen to the song before I play it just to make sure it's okay and it doesn't have bad words or anything in it. But I say that I want to be her because I've always liked her. Actually, that's true. I've always liked her since she was with No Doubt. And then I liked her even more when she came out with her solo projects. And I know this is completely not school related, but this is just getting to know me a little bit better. I just like her because I think she just has her own style about her, and it's a style that I would never be able to pull off, but she pulls it off. But I always have to remind myself that she is 47 years old and she looks amazing. If I could look like that at 47 years old, then life is great. And she's 47 years old, but she still feels youthful. Like, if I were to talk to her or when I hear her, I don't think of her as a 47-year-old. I don't even think of an age. And I just feel like if I met her in person, we would be friends. So I just thought I would share my obsession with Gwen Stefani with you because I was just listening to a song of hers. Anyway, it is 4:30 and I'm actually wrapping up for the day. I have read all my response journals for the day. Luckily, I am not behind. I had a pretty good day. We had the Imagination Machine earlier today and I took a little bit of video from it, and hopefully I'll be able to include it unless something goes wrong with it. But the video that I took was of them performing one of my students' stories. So it's, for me, I tell the kids it's an honor if they read your story and decide to act it out, and what a great memory to have. So I told his parents about it. They were there in the audience and they videotaped it as well. And I asked him afterwards if he liked their interpretation of his story, and he laughed and he said he did. So we had the Imagination Machine story assembly today. We did chapter 10 math review. I did the same Kagan activity, which is called Find Someone Who, where the kids are kind of milling about the classroom and partnering up and doing problems for each other. And I'm walking around watching them do it as well. And I always pick the problems that are really straightforward. I don't give the problems that I think are a little bit more complicated or more involved because I don't want them to feel defeated before they even get started. And I had a parent come in to observe that process. This is the same parent that is this is the same parent that initially wanted to be able to sit down with their child every time their child took a test, just as a visual reminder of their child to take their time. And that was an idea that I thought sounded good in theory to a parent, but logistically and developmentally, to me, it's not a good idea for a fifth grader, and really for any child in any grade level, because it's not realistic for a parent to be there with you every time you take a test. Like, that just is not realistic. So he came in today just to kind of look over how we reviewed so that he can kind of see what was going on. And then he's coming in tomorrow. The principal is allowing this parent to have their child take the test in a separate setting with him in the room and the principal in the room, just because we're trying to cancel out some different concerns that the parents might have. So this should just be a one-time thing so we can get some answers from that. So that happened. That it's always a little nerve-wracking having a parent in the classroom, but he was actually quite nice and he was here for about an hour. And then we went about our day. We continued to do what we needed to do, did a little bit of wonders. Did some social studies, did some readers workshops. I called a couple kids back to talk to them about their response journals. I'm gonna hold off on assigning them what I want them to write about, but I just reminded them that in the back of their journals, I have one in front of me, they have this little list of different topic ideas that they could talk about, so that if they feel like they're getting to a point where they don't really know what to write about, which I think is causing them, some of them, to write just very subpar responses to what they're reading, they have that list. Instead of assigning them what to do, I might restrict them for a minute from using the ask questions strategy or the making predictions, because right now I'm feeling like those are like cop-out responses for a lot of the kids, because they're just asking random questions and making random predictions. So it's a constant reteaching. So I pulled some kids back that were like really doing that and just reiterated what the purpose of this journal is, and had a whole class conversation about it. I also know that I am new to this process, and there are some things that I probably need to be better about. Like, I need to be better about mini lessons and things like that. And I have to just realize everybody's new at it. So it's gonna start off a little rocky and hopefully get better over the course of this trimester for them, but also over the course of my teaching lifetime for me if I continue to do it. So that happened, and then after school, I had a great surprise. One of my students from last year came to visit, and this happens frequently, but this particular student, I have known her since she was in the first grade, and I don't know if I mentioned her before, but she's popped by once before earlier in the year and gave me a gift for Halloween, but I had her brother in fifth grade, and when her brother was in fifth grade, she was in first. And so I've known her since she was in first grade, and all throughout elementary here, she would always, when it was Valentine's Day or when it was my birthday, she would always give me a little treat and tell me, I want to be in your class when I'm in fifth grade. And then fifth grade came and she was in my class, and I was so happy. So her and her mom came by, and they're just one of those families that only come around once in a while, and when you get to have them and get to work with them, it's just such a pleasure. So they came by to do two things. One, I can't find it right now. Let's see. Here it is. I'll get that later. One thing that they came by for was the mom came to drop me off this folder of fifth grade promotion ideas, because she knows it's that time of year where we're planning the fifth grade promotion ceremony, and she was on the decorations committee last year. And so just an example of how great she is, she took time out of her day to come here to my class to give me this folder that just has images of previous promotion ceremonies that we've had. And we've been doing this for 3 years, and so where we had these committees. And so the first year was this red carpet theme. So she had pictures that she got a hold of and printed out for the new moms. And this was our first year, and it was amazing. Like, look, these moms had a red carpet that year with some red roping to make the kids feel special. Then after promotion, they created this whole like step and repeat area where people came and took pictures that also had a red carpet. The inside of the cafeteria was an Oscar theme, and then there were just little decorations on the wall. So this was a wall with all the teachers on it that said VIP, and it was really cute. It was really amazing. And then last year was a Hawaiian theme, so this was the entrance of the school, and these were all moms that got these items together, made these items, bought some of these items, I'm pretty sure. So this is how they decorated the cafeteria last year for promotion. So she just came by and gave me this folder to give to the moms of this year, so they had an idea of some of the things that they had done, which she didn't have to do. And then on top of that, they know my birthday is coming up. I think this is what it was for, and if not, it was just like a little pick-me-up. They know that I love me some Diet Dr. Pepper, so they bought me a bottle of Diet Dr. Pepper. They know I love chocolate, so they brought me a creamy peanut butter Twix, Reese's Pieces, and a Snickers. And it's a small gesture, but it's a gesture nonetheless. Like, I know this mom is busy. She has two kids. She's a very involved parent. Her kids are very active. And so for her to stop by here and give me this to pass on to this year's moms, and then the little treat, just made me feel special. And it makes those days that are difficult worth it, because you know there are people out there that appreciate what you are trying to do with their child, and students out there that appreciate it. So if you're out there, Mrs. Yazelle, or if you ever for some reason watch this, thank you so much. You guys really mean a lot to me as a family, and I really do appreciate all the things that you've done for me over the years, because it's been years now. So that was the bright spot of my teaching day.
Good morning, here's my outfit of the day. Today I am wearing a sweater from Old Navy, my jeans because it's Friday, my zip-up little fake combat boots that I got from Macy's, and just a silver and gold Michael Kors watch, and that's pretty much it. I'm just keeping it simple. So happy Friday, everyone. I will talk to you guys later.
Everyone, it is 4:50 and I am getting ready to head home on a Friday. I stayed later because I decided to grade the response journals that were due today, so I didn't have to haul them home. I will be coming in tomorrow because tomorrow is my cleaning lady. So you guys know that I come in on Saturdays when she's here, so I'm out of her way. And that means I will be in here lesson planning tomorrow, so I'm not planned for the week as of right now. So, today they just basically took a test on chapter 10 of Go Math, and we did not teach chapter 10 last year or the year before, apparently. This is the first year we've taught it. I think we've always tried to combine elements of chapter 10 with chapter 11 to kind of get that last squeeze in before state testing. So, this was the first year we taught the whole chapter, and therefore the first year that we administered it. And I'm not sure how it's going to go because this whole chapter is on measurement. So they were dealing with customary units of measurement and metric units of measurement. And our concern is it's just a lot for them to memorize. Like they were not given conversion charts on the test or anything like that. I feel pretty good about my kids knowing their customary units of measurement because Mrs. Chu found a little quiz that she gave her class, and I gave it to mine, and pretty much all of them did very well on it. But there was only one lesson on metric measurements, and the lesson really kind of focused on understanding that when they were converting metric measurements, they could just use their knowledge of powers of 10. And I still feel like it was just that lesson, that one lesson wasn't quite enough. So normally I don't do this, but for their test today, I did put this little metric chart up on the board that kind of helps them to know how to convert using their powers of 10 a little bit easier. So I haven't graded it. I don't have any frame of reference. Like, I don't know historically how this chapter test goes because I've never given it. So we will see. Half of my class isn't even done with the test, so it was taking them a while. So I will probably grade the half that are done just to kind of see, and then let the other kids finish on Monday. I'm a little nervous because even one of my higher students in math, she was just freaking out taking the test. Like, I had to talk her through it in the beginning because she started off saying, I am not going to remember any of my measurements and this is going to be so hard. And she was saying all of this as we were wrapping up reviewing for it and before I was passing it out. So I had to like talk her down because she's the type that if she does not get an A, like, she just really is hard on herself. And I don't want her to grow up putting that kind of pressure on her. It's good to have high expectations for yourself, but you don't want them to be so high that you can't relax or understand that you are allowed to make a mistake. So I told her, I had to remind her, I said, you've taken this test already. Because if you know Go Math, the review tests are the exact same thing as the real test, with the exception of names being changed, scenarios and word problems being changed, numbers being changed. So I told her, you've pretty much already taken this test. You know what to expect. It's just gonna be slightly different. So she still was like, well, I don't know. So then she got started and she was stuck on like number three or one of the first three problems. So I kept telling her to skip it. Don't waste all your energy stressing about that one problem. Skip it, go to the ones you know, and then come back. I don't think she took that advice, but she eventually got to the point where whatever question she was stuck on, she felt better about it. And then later on in the test, she's like, oh, this test isn't so hard anymore. And I said, I know, you need to believe in yourself. So I told her, if you tell yourself you're not going to be able to do it, you're not going to be able to. But she struggled. So when one of your students that's typically high is struggling, it makes you a little nervous. So we'll see. If the whole class doesn't do well, I'll have to kind of tweak how I grade it or how I weight it. So that was the bulk of our day. We reviewed a little bit more for the math test. They took the math test, took a states and capitals test. I had something planned for Wonders, but we didn't get to it. So that will be pushed till Monday. But the exciting news of the day is I got the results of my transfer request, and I will be at, it would be, remember, it was between middle school and the new school, and I was going back and forth, but I officially found out that I will be heading to the new school in our district, and I am so excited about it.